And what as a travail upon a human child, and we shall not escape. They shall not escape in the end, it should not be strange to us, because they have neglected the salvation Jesus has, and I don't have a
Father, we thank you for a time like this. Sit exalted in Jesus' name. Father, we pray you speak to us directly from the throne in the name of Jesus. Glorify yourself in our midst in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for your name. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Good evening, everybody, once again. Amen.
Amen.
I told us earlier, those of us that were heavy, I told us that we'll be deliberating on some things today. So what we'll be talking about today is a love feast, isn't it?
Yes.
The pastor from Lugansk. Okay, let me introduce him to you officially. For the sake of those of you who don't know him, this is Pastor D.G. Hallelujah. Amen. From Dikala to Lugansk. Amen. That's from another city. For those of you who don't know where Lugansk is, it's another city in Ukraine. Amen. So I'm sorry for not introducing him earlier. He's been with us since yesterday. Amen. And he's just been here, you know, to be a blessing to us. Amen. Amen. Now you have been getting it all the while, right?
Yes.
So God bless you. You're still going to get more of it. Amen. So we want to discuss some things. Like he rightly said while he was talking, he said this is not Sunday service. It's not, yes, it's a love feast. So you should be free to express yourself, isn't it? And that's just what we are going to do. So now, I am not going to preach to us. I said we are going to deliberate on some matters. Amen. So that means we want to discuss, isn't it? Okay. I want to go through some things and want us all to pay attention and let's reason together on what we are talking about. Amen. Are you reasoning with me? Okay, are you going to reason with me?
Yes.
Oh, you are not ready yet.
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay. I told you something earlier. I said we all here, our decision matters. Can you remember I said that?
Yes.
And it's time to view those decisions now. And if you want your decision to matter, I think you should decide aright. Are you with me? Yes. Start reasoning. Take up your pen. Your book, your notebook, anything you need to use to aid your reasoning. Gather it up together and let's reason together. Amen.
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 You remember what the Bible says in the book of Isaiah chapter 1 verse 18? It said what? God bless you. Amen.
Amen.
It said, come, let us
reason together.
So, that's all. So, come and let's reason together. And that's just the call of God at this very time. God is here, you know that? And he wants to reason with us. Now, let us look at it. What we really want to reason about is the kingdom of this world. Are you with me? Listen very carefully. We want to reason about the kingdom of this world and who rules the world and what has it been like. And what are we meant to do, viewing the kingdom of this very world we are in? Someone in the history, listen very carefully. I will go a bit into the history, I will get to the present, and we will take a little glance at what the future will be, depending on what we decide here this evening. Are you with me? Let me take us back to history. Someone in the history was so dedicated and concerned about the kingdom of this world. He was so concerned about it. He dedicated his own attention to the person that can tell him about the kingdom of the world. Amen. You know, we have different needs on earth. Do you know that? The first need, they can class needs to be physiological need, psychological need, aesthetic needs, And what else again? The needs can be classified. But the major need is to eat and live, isn't it? To eat, food, clothing, and shelter. Then as time goes on, the need starts to rise within people. That a kind of a need for belief. Are you with me? To believe or to have a kind of association with the deity. Amen. Okay, we want to believe there is something supernatural that is beyond the natural that we can depend on for our sustainability. Amen. So while in quest of that, men found God. Amen. Okay, men found different gods. I'm going to the history so that we can know what we are deliberating on today. Men found different gods and they call different things God. Amen. But having seen all these things, we are able to discover that there is only one true God. Are you still with me? Only one through
God
that created everything. Both the other little gods that people later discovered. One God created them all. Amen. So now, this young man happened to know this God. He was one of those people that were opportune to discover this God early enough. Then he was praying to this God, inquiring. You know, people have existed before him that knew that God. Listen very carefully. People have existed before him, they knew that God. They saw some things, they put in record. Everything they see, because what we are doing today will be put in record. Amen. They put it in record for those who are coming behind. Then he went through all these things. Then he needed clarity. He said, okay, the people that wrote these things are no more alive. But the God that spoke to them is still alive. Then he went ahead to seek this God more. Tell me more about these things. And the God revealed to him different things. Listen to me. And those things are what you are not able to do. God revealed to him different things. And to the extent that God showed him everything that has happened before him, everything that is happening in his days, and God showed him some extra things. He said, keep this one. He said, seal it up. It's not for now. He said, it's for the future. Do you know the man I'm talking about?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Do you know that man?
Yes.
If you know it, wave your hands. Okay, let somebody be able to ask, who is that person?
Daniel.
Ah! Okay, that was Daniel. He inquired. He wanted to know what would happen. And the Bible made us to know that an excellent spirit was found in him. Are you listening to me? So, then there was a king in the days of Daniel. Daniel was just a slave boy. He was brought in as an exile, you know, from Israel. So Daniel was just a slave boy there. And they selected some of them. It was a prince. Some of the princes, they selected and said, bring them up, feed them well, and nurture them, let them be wise enough to be able to deliberate like those of you that are here today. To be able to think and decide, you know, on things that matters with the king. And Daniel was one of them. And one thing happened. Like many of you have dreams, and some of you forget. How many of you forget your dreams here? God bless you. No, be sincere. It's not a crime to forget your dream.
Sometimes.
Amen. And everything that makes you forget your dream, the Lord will destroy tonight in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, your dream is a link between you and the spiritual. Are you with me? In your daytime, your life activity is so full of noise, and even when God speaks to you, you might not hear him. Are you with me? But the way you can easily get a clue into the spiritual is at night when you are sleeping. That one is common to everybody. Are you with me? Now, so not everybody can see vision, but everybody can dream. Are you with me? So this king had a dream. The dream was a very significant one. But those things that makes people forget dream came to the king and stole the dream away. Sir, this thing is too much for you to have and just wake up and say, oh, see what I saw. He stole the dream away from the king. And the king was a very great king. He woke up. But as great as he was, he could not defeat that thing that came to steal the dream away. Then he now transferred the aggression on the wise men he has been feeding. Saying, people have been eating my food in vain. He said, go and find my dream for me. He said, they came to steal it. He said, oh king. He said, this thing you're asking for, it's so strange. How do you say we go get your dream? Dream is, it's no substance. You know, where do we go and look for it? He said, no, go and find the dream and tell me the interpretation of the dream. He said, king, just try to think. Think more and more and more. You can remember and we will tell you the interpretation. And the king said, I will not even believe your interpretation if you cannot tell me what the dream is. He said, because you have been lying to me all this while. He said, if truly you are wise, get my dream for me, then I will believe your interpretation. Then he said he was going to kill all of them. He said, they have just been eating in vain. Amen. And the news got to this young man. Because he was one of the wise men. Though he did not eat the king's food. The king didn't know he was eating his food. But he said, I was going to kill all of them that have eaten his food. Because they have been wasting his food for no reason. Then he got to the young man. He said, we're going to kill you, Daniel. He said, the king ordered that we kill all of you. You have all been eating the king's food in vain. Now you cannot interpret, you cannot even find the king's dream for him. And Daniel said, I didn't even hear about this. But they felt Daniel was too small. That let's tell those that are more skilled in wisdom, you know, that they can even do it. They're not even Daniel. Then he said, why is the demand of the king so, you know, so much, I mean, so hasty? Then he said, okay, let the king give me a little time. Let him give us a little time. And we will find out that dream. Amen. Mm-hmm. Then the God that does the supernatural came into sin. Because Daniel knew the God that gave the dream. You know, I told you at the beginning that he read the story from some prophets. He needed to understand. But the prophets are dead. But he knew the God that gave those things is still alive. He sought that God. And that God gave it to him. Then when the dream came and was taken away, he remembered also that the God that gave the dream was still there. Instead of leaving Nebuchadnezzar alone, let him go and look for the dream for him. Then he went back to God and God revealed it to him. Isn't that amazing? We are here somewhere. Is anybody following me? Oh, some people are sleeping already. Okay. We are not going to shout. We are all discussing something. But I only want you to get the basis for our deliberation. Amen. Amen. So it went on that way. Then he came and he prayed, he sought the face of God, and God gave him that dream. Because God was powerful enough to collect the dream from the thief. Because that is his mission. It's on a suicide mission. He said the thief cometh, but to do what? To steal one? To kill and to what? He said, but I am come that you might have life. And have it more? Abundant. Then he collected the dream from the man and said, okay, I gave Nebuchadnezzar. He was so powerful in the physical, but in the spiritual. A little demon came to steal the dream away from him. So let me give Daniel. Daniel is so little, but in the spiritual, no demon can come near him to steal the dream away. Then he gave it to Daniel. Then Daniel woke up and went to the king to tell the dream to the king. Then he called the king, said, live forever, O king. And who was that king? I mentioned his name. That's why I was hanging up the names of the people involved. Then he said, this in your dream. Daniel chapter 2, from verse 31. And he went on, he said, in this dream, you saw a statue, so tall, big, mighty, with a head of gold, with an arm of silver, and the thigh of brass, and the legs of iron. Then the feet was iron mixed with mighty clay. Then the king said, yes, I remember. So that was it. And Daniel looked up to God again and said, yes, God is still there. You know, because I was wiser than all these ones, or that they will know that there is a God that dwells in heaven and rules in the affairs of man. So he said, you saw this statue. It was standing. Listen very carefully. That dream was so important. That was why the devil stole it away from the organizer. He said he was standing and he was was standing. You were wondering, what is this statue about? What's going to happen to this statue? So suddenly, till the stone was cut out without a hand, and the stone came and hit the statue at the feet, where the iron was mixed with what? God bless you. I wanted to know if you are following me. The feet was iron mixed with mighty clay. It struck the feet, and what happened? Suddenly, the whole big mighty statue exploded. And what happened? Both the gold, the brass, the silver, the iron, everything just turned to dust and was blown away. And he said, yes, that was it. Then he said, now you have been able to get my dream. So what is the dream talking about? And he said, and this is the interpretation thereof. And he began. He said, thou, O king, you are a mighty king, and you are a king of kings. He said, every creature under the earth, man, animals, and everything that the Lord has put in your care, listen very carefully, that the Lord has put them under you. Little did he know that it was God that gave him dominion. He felt he was so brave, and he went on conquering and to conquer. But said, God gave you dominion over all these people. He said, you are a great king. You are the head of good. Said, yes. I'm happy to hear that first part. I am the head of gold. He said, yes. Yes. He said, can you see that arm of silver? Another kingdom will come after you. Listen very carefully. We are deliberating the kingdom of this world. He said, after you, another kingdom will come. And that second kingdom will be inferior to you. You are still happy again. Oh, so I'm still the greatest. Amen. He said, that kingdom will be inferior to you. That is the arm. Amen. Open through the Bible. The first place the word kingdom was mentioned was talking about Babel. Amen. Amen. So Nebuchadnezzar there was the king of Babylon. Are you with me? We are going somewhere. So he said, another kingdom will come after you, but you'll be a bit inferior to you. He said, okay. Then he said, okay, that's the arm of silver. And what happened then? What next? He said, you see the tie of bronze, another kingdom will come. Do you know, as they go further, they are reducing in quality, but increasing in strength. Are you with me? He said, the part of bronze, another kingdom inferior to the former. Said, okay, and what else? And the leg of iron. Said, another kingdom. Very strong kingdom. He said, even as iron dashes all things, you know, it will go on breaking and conquering and like that. Said, okay. Then he now said, can you see the iron mixed with mighty clay? He said, yes, what about it? He said, at a point in time, that kingdom will not hold. They will try to mix up with the seed of man, but they will not stand. Just like iron cannot mix up with mighty clay. And I said, what is all these things? What are you really talking about? I said, the kingdom has not ended yet. He said, you know, a stone that came, there was something particular about that stone. Said the stone was cut without a hand. Said yes. Said it came down and destroyed that statue. And he said, like chaff before the wind, it blew off. You know what chaff is? Yes, when they are harvesting. Many of you grew up in the city. You have not even gone close to the farm before. Amen. Yes, but when they harvest something like wheat and those things like that, the chaff are the very, very light things, okay? Many of you like to take oats here. You see those things that used to be hard in your mouth when you are taking oats? That's the chaff. You know, they can easily be blown by the wind. Amen. So they blew off. Okay? And that stone did not destroy. Stone, no, we didn't say Diamond, though. You know, diamond is hardest substance. I think you all did sciences.
Yeah.
Yes. It wasn't diamond that broke all these mighty metals. Said a stone broke them and they scattered. And when they scattered, this stone did not disappear. It did not even break. Amen. But this stone now stood. And it said, became bigger and bigger and bigger and filled the whole earth. Amen. Mm-hmm. Nebuchadnezzar had that then. Said, oh, is that it? Okay, it doesn't really matter what happens after me. But you said, I am the head of gold. Said, yes, king. Okay. And the next thing that came on Nebuchadnezzar's mind was to build a statue of gold. Then he said, I am the head of gold. So let me build a statue of gold and let everybody begin to worship. That was Nebuchadnezzar's understanding of the vision. Amen. So I'm pleased to tell you that that king called Nebuchadnezzar, he was the first ruler of the world, the first world empire. Are you still with me? He was the first person that was able to subdue the world and rule the world. Amen. But something was in him. They told him it was the head of gold. Pride came inside of him. Do you understand? He said it was the head of gold. The first thing he went to raise that statue, everybody bowed. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, I will not bow. He said, no, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, I just heard you say this. No, I think they didn't mean it. I mean, I think it wasn't true. They only want to rob you. He said, no. He said, okay, but eventually maybe you don't understand the instruction. I said, when you hear the sound of the trumpet, the cornet, the cymbals, and he said, everyone should bow to this golden statue. And they repeated it. Someone would have said, why did Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego just bend down to adjust the lace of their shoe? You know, nobody would have been able to see them that they did not bow. You know, they would have just tried to adjust the lace of their shoe. Say, God, I'm not bowing to the image, you know, I'm just adjusting my own. And he said, how dare you? Have you forgotten that I've subdued the whole earth? I took you, I subdued the whole earth, I took you captive from your country. And I destroyed your God's temple. And I took all what belongs to your God. And he said, who is that God that will deliver you out of my hand? Said the God that could not deliver himself when I was taking all what belongs to him in the temple. Pride came inside him. And the young boys faced him and said, king, with all due respect, sir, he said, yes, our God is able to save us from this fire. If not hard, maybe he saved someone from fire before, but they believe he can do it. He said, even if he doesn't save us, we don't mind. Let's die. He said, but O king, we will not bow to this statue. And what happened? Did the Lord save them?
Yes.
He said, there is a God in heaven.
Yes.
That rules in the affairs of man. They went into the fire and they became the first person to walk freely in the fire, and not even their clothes got that anointing, did not get burned. They came out. Then that was not enough to make this king, the great king, the first king ruling the whole world. That was not enough to make him humble himself. He stood up one day and started walking in his empire. He looked around, said, are all these things are belonging to me? You can imagine. If I want that boy dead now, if I just look at him and do like this, they know what it means without talking. He's dead. Said, if I look at that one's wife, I say, I divorce you. Immediately it happened. He started looking at the things he could achieve by his power. And he said, is this me? And he looked at himself as though there was no one that can handle him. Then God in heaven looked down. And he said, he that sitteth in heaven shall laugh. And he laughed. It was just the laughter of God that broke Nebuchadnezzar down. He was on his knee. He struggled to get up. Said, no, that's where you are staying. See, because as long as the earth remains, said, every knee shall bow to him. He tried to get up, his hand went down, and he struggled. He said, that is the position you will be till the next 7 years. Then when the general of the army, for instance, you just meet him suddenly, started cutting tree and he was eating tree, and what do you do? Everybody ran away. So the palace does not fit you anymore. Everybody in the palace and the people you have been controlling, they work on 2 legs. But you have started working on 4. You went into the forest to live with them for 7 years. Are you still with me? I was the king of the first empire. Amen. He regarded God before he died. After 7 years, for 7 years, God did not give him the opportunity to look, to see the sky, to even look up. The dew and the rain for 7 years started and ended on him. Amen. Then he handed over to, he died, he passed on. He handed over to his son, and his son does not even want to know where God is. And his son carried his girl, his concubines, and everybody said, that's what Mary. My father has fought the war. All I need to do is to be enjoying. He said, this cups you are serving with are not reasonable. So what of the cup they got from the temple of those people called Jews? Say, go and get them for me. Say, but I think they said they're sacred. Say, no, no, what is sacred? He said, what do you mean by that? Bring everything, and they brought it. Daniel was still there. And they brought it and they started drinking and they were marrying, and suddenly the hand came and wrote on the wall. And you know, they are not terrified by anything because they use a lot of magical power. Say, yes, if the hand can write, all I need to look for is someone that can read it and let's know what he's talking about. And they looked for all these magicians, could not read again. But Daniel was still. I said, there's a man who was here in the days of your father. He said, in whom the spirit of the true God, the holy God, lives. Say, go get him for me. They got Daniel. And he got there. He looked at it. And he read it. Oh. It was just your death sentence they wrote on the wall. And he was still there celebrating. Say, this is your death sentence. Say, what? Say, they said, you wait. I found wanting. And the Bible made us to know that that very night, the Medo-Persian soldiers, they were already crossing the river, heading towards Belshazzar. He was going to die that night. And he enjoyed himself, he drank, and what happened? That very night, he was killed. Then, we have the arm of what? Is anybody following me, please? The arm of what? Arm, 1, 2. Medi, the Medo-Persian government. Medes and the Persian. Amen. They took over from there. And they continued. What was the weakness of the first king? And they continued. The Medo-Persian government, there are 2 of them. You know, at a point in time, this one, and this one, and this one, the 2 of them could not hold. The Persians subdued the Medes. Amen. And afterwards, there come a young man. That's the most amazing thing among all these people that have written. Amen. This very young man appeared from nowhere. You don't even know who he was. Then he came suddenly. A young boy! Can you guess how old he was? Okay, I won't tell you. But this young man came with bravery. He just came up and said, these people, they have been subduing nations. He said, I think we can go up and face them and solve this. He said, go. Your father just died. Do you know what you're talking about at all? He said, forget about it. He said, what? Do you know the number of soldiers these people have? He said, don't worry. He said, let's go. We are able to go. Then he gathered 35,000 soldiers, listening very carefully, to fight the world. Amen. Amen. Is anybody with me? He gathered just 35,000 soldiers. He was so confident in himself. Let us go. And this time, the soldier of these people that they are going to fight was created to be about 1 million. Can you imagine that? Say, let's go. Say, do you know, let us go. Okay, if you say we should go, we are going. And he went on, and went on, and went on. And this young man was, he now overcame, and he became the first, I mean, the youngest person to ever rule the world. And who was that?
Sasha the Great.
God bless you. You people know the history very well. It was just at the age of 22 when he led the soldiers, team of 35,000 soldiers, to fight the present world ruler. And they overcame him. Because they could not stand. I told you there were two. They could not stand. Are you with me? They were not fully united. It destroyed the Persian government. And Alexander the Great, they called him the Great because he was too young. You understand? They felt there was nothing they could say about him than to add great to his name. He conquered the world with 35,000 soldiers at the age of 22. And this young man, he was so confident of himself, he should have known that before he would dare to fight the world with 35,000 soldiers. So this confidence rises on in him. He enjoys to marry immediately after winning a battle. They come on, get us a drink and let's drink and celebrate and everybody go, yeah, hey, yeah, we won. Tomorrow is another day. And he kept on going on that way. On and on, he loved to drink so much. He loved it so much. Like some people will not leave until every bottle is empty and until they say there's no more in the fridge. Okay, I can go. Amen. He loved to drink so much. And he drank and drank. And he was at a place called Baghdad, still on a mission to still subdue one nation. And this sickness came on him. And after about 10 days, during the sickness, he was still addressing his soldiers because he was so confident that it doesn't matter, I will still go, I will still overcome. Still telling them on how to go and subdue India and some other places. He still kept telling them like that, but the next time that followed, the sickness hooked him up and brought him down. That was the end of Alexander the Great. And what was his weakness? You can call it pride, but not as much as Nebuchadnezzar. Drunkenness. Are you with me? Drunkenness. He conquered the world, but he could not conquer himself. He could not conquer the strange thing inside of him. And that one came out and conquered him. Amen. So when the kingdom went that way, the next world power came. That was Rome. Amen. Then the Rome too came, subdued and subdued and subdued. When Alexander was dying, he said he left the kingdom in the hands of the bravest warrior. So fight and kill yourself. Anyone that can kill every other person becomes the next leader. But the Roman soldiers got up one day and said, oh, the Alexander the Great is gone. Then we have so many people that are little. Then let's go there and subdue them. And it went on like that. That means the urge for power and control has been since ages, isn't it? So then the Roman soldiers came up and they were okay. Roman soldier, what part of the body are they? Wait. Just take carefully the head of gold, the arm of silver, the thigh of bronze, brass, yes, and the leg of who? The Roman soldiers. Leg of iron. And you never said they would keep dashing out and destroy them. And they were there. They kept on their mission. They went on. conquering not to conquer. Amen. They were the ones that remained there till the birth of Jesus. Do you know that?
Yes.
We started from the far distance to the present. And like that, so they were there, they subdued and subdued. And what happened to Caesar? Amen. Caesar was a dictator. As the head of the Roman Empire. It was so serious that I told you one time in the church that when the Roman soldiers were going to take over England, the English soldiers heard that they were going to come through the sea and they went to Montauk. Their soldiers, okay, let's just go and wait for them. They are coming. And the Roman soldiers saw them gathered. They said, we are not bothered. We are the iron that dashes everything. We got there, they got there, and they came out of their ship. Immediately they did what? They set their ship on fire. Say, can you just see that? So we are coming to stay, we're not going back. And like the Bible talked about it, that the iron that actually they dashed down in England and they took over. Amen. Amen. So now, Caesar was a dictator. You know, everyone when they get there, they get so full of themselves. And Caesar was to die because the people under him were not enjoying him. He doesn't listen to anybody. And his own people conspired against him. In the Senate meeting, they arraigned and they killed him. They called him to the meeting. Some people told him the rumor escaped to his ears. Say, Caesar. Say, they said they are going to do this to you. Say, the wife had several drinks. The friends said, come on. Sir, as strong as you are you a man at all? Then you'll be listening to the dream of a woman? Say, don't forget about that. Just come, they are waiting for you. And he said, okay, I'm coming. And he went down and he never came back. That was the end of the Roman. Amen. That was the end of Caesar, you know, the leader of the Roman Empire. And what happened? Listen very carefully. Since then, the Roman Empire lost its stand. But let us reason. Remember, he said, the feet. It is still that iron that reached that feet. Mixed with my clay. That means it did not totally end there. Amen. Caesar died, but the Roman Empire did not actually end there. That means the Roman Empire is still coming back. But they will not stand like they stood before. And you need to be very careful. They are coming in through different ways. Amen. They're coming in through different ways. And they're still coming back to rule the world, but not the world as a whole. Amen. And already as I'm talking to you now, they're already ruling part of the world. That's a mystery. Read Revelation chapter 17. Someone was described in that place. The person was described to details, even to the appearance, to the clothes she's wearing, and everything like that, and to what with what she fed the nations. The Roman Empire. Are you with me? Then they will not hold the mix up. They are penetrating through religion. I won't say more than that. You should understand what I'm talking about. He that has understanding, let him. They are penetrating through religion. But they will try to mix up with the seed of man. But just as the mighty clay cannot mix up with the iron, they will not. Then finally, that stone was cut out without hand. And it came, and it came, and dashed it out. I'm going to tell you something. These are different kingdoms. They would have appeared differently. I think the question should come to us that, why do they all appear as one image? Can anybody answer that? And why do different kingdoms, you know, appear as one image, as one person? I think it's a question which you ask. I said we are going to deliberate today, isn't it?
Yes.
There is something particular about that. And why will that stone destroy all the kingdoms at once? Why didn't it destroy Nebuchadnezzar first and come later to destroy Medo-Persia, then the Greeks, that's the Greek under Alexander, and you know, the Roman? Amen. I'm going to explain to you, because another man is coming. Listen very carefully. Another man is
coming.
And that man that is coming will not come with the power of Nebuchadnezzar and with the splendor of Nebuchadnezzar. Listen very carefully. He will not come with the strength or the ability to unite that the Medo-Persian never had. He won't come with that. He will not come the tire with the courage and boldness of Alexander the Great alone. Then he will not just come with the power to dash nations that the Roman soldiers had. He will come with all these things together. All the attributes of Nebuchadnezzar to the Medo-Persian, to the Greek, and to the Roman, it will come together with everything. And when it comes, the Bible says the whole world will wonder after him. He has insight into everything. When you come here, you say, there's always a problem in Israel. Israel and the Palestinians say, don't worry, let's go there. And Israel will come and say, oh, why have you been all this while? We don't know we can ever be at peace with those people. And they will say, yeah, the economic situation of the country is, don't worry, we will do that. It's okay, look at this, they say, don't worry, he will have insight into everything. And who is this person we're talking about?
Antichrist.
God bless you. That's the Antichrist. Amen. That's the Antichrist. So he's the one appearing with the power of all this government. Nebuchadnezzar will not rule like he will rule. He will rule. You understand what I'm saying? The Roman cannot dash nations like he will dash nations. The Bible says, and by peace, it will do what? It will destroy. By peace. He will look at you and smile and say, don't worry. And everybody will love him. Before he says, in fact, people will come and surrender their countries to him. Say, come and rule us. Presidents will surrender to him. Say, it's you we want. We know, okay, they will form union. Do you know there's word union already?
Yeah.
Don't know? There is word union. You understand? They are preparing for him. Because all these kingdoms have been reflected except the kingdom of the Antichrist. Are you with me? And it is that kingdom, when it has appeared as the whole everything, then the stone that was cut out hand comes. I've not read any portion of the scripture to you yet. Are you still following me? Amen. Now the stone will be cut without hand. It will appear finally to destroy all the arrangements that have been set since history. Are you there? Daniel chapter 2 from verse 31 to the end. Don't bother to read, just write it down. You read it at home. Amen. The Babylonian Empire was between 605 to 539 BC, 66 years. The Medo-Persian government was between 539 to 331 BC, 208 years. The Grecian Empire was between 331 to 168 BC, 163 years. That's the type of brass. Then the Roman Empire was between 168 BC to 40. You understand? The Roman Empire was born when Jesus Christ was born. Do you get what I'm saying? Amen. So that's a leg of iron. And it has not been suppressed totally. I told you, they are still on. They are still ruling under religion. Amen. The religion inside is part of the thing the Antichrist will have also. You understand? And they said very soon, he said, the abomination that make it desolate, as was spoken of by Daniel, when you see him standing in the holy place, after doing everything, and people went after him, he said that, cancel out these gods. What do you mean by God? There is no God. He said, it will subdue everything. And he himself will stand as God to be worshipped. Said the daily sacrifice will be ended and everything. Forget about it. And everyone will not see any reason to seek after any God because they have seen what he could do without this God. Amen. Then finally the stone cold out of hand. And I told you something, I'm going to tell you now, so I'll be running up my talk. Because we are going to deliberate. We are going to deliberate the last kingdom. And that's the kingdom that will last forever. Jesus spoke about it in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. It said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is... The whole Bible is circled round about that kingdom. The governor asked him, he said, you are a king. Is it true? He said, my kingdom is not of this world. He said, if it were to be of this world, my servants will not even allow you to touch me. Amen. Amen. They would have come and destroyed you and bundled you out. Amen. Amen. What am I talking about? Now, I told you something. Listen very carefully. I'm almost rounding up. Then maybe I will leave room for questions. You write it down. But I want you to get the things fully. Say we are deliberating on this spot. Now, something happened. When did God rest from all his labors? During creation. Seventh day, isn't it? I want us to calculate something. I just want to tell us. Some of you here have done it for you before, but there are many new faces here I want you to know. Now, on the seventh day, God rested. And look at it. From the days from the creation to the days of Noah, how many years was that? 2,000 years. I want you all have your pen and your Bible. I said we are deliberating. Just calculate with me. 2,000 years from the days of, from the creation to the days of Noah. Are you with me? Then, from the days of Noah, you know, at the days of Noah, God did what? God swept the whole world away by flood, isn't it? Then the days of Noah till the birth of Jesus was another 2,000 years. Is anybody still with me? Calculate that for me. How many years? 4,000 years. Then from the days of the death of Jesus till this very time, is how many years? 2,000 and? Amen. So add it up together, how many years in all?
6,000
and? Okay. Open up the book of 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. Display it for those who did not even come with the Bible. It said, but beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day with the Lord, as what? It said, and the 1,000 years as? So if this 1,000 years of ours is just a day to God, how many days has God spent since creation? Let somebody answer this. 6 days and some microseconds. Amen. Are you getting what I'm talking about? We have listed the story that talk about every kingdom from beginning to the end. All this kingdom has been fulfilled. Daniel chapter 2. The last verse says, this dream is true and the interpreter is certain. After interpretation, it will surely happen. Amen. So now, when every of these kingdoms has their surfaced, then we are already that justified that the 6 days has passed for God. Then the seventh day God needs to rest. That's why many people felt at the year 2000 the rapture will take place. Are you with me? But the Bible says in this same Peter, go back to the chapter, verse 7. The verse 9, the next verse. It said, but the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness. It said, but is long suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Are you with me? God has not forgotten that he needed to rest at the seventh day. But he thought of it, that my rest and this soul's been destroyed. Which one should I pick? Then God has given us a grace since 2000. When his 6 days was complete for him to rest. He has given us a grace since 2000, another 13 years added. That you and I might come together. We are meant to form the kingdom together. He's not going to rule the kingdom without you. He has given us that grace. 13 years! Then these 13 years, I describe it as, how many of you watch football here? You love football very well. I don't seriously like it. But if I meet people watching, I watch with them. When they must imagine a winner, maybe a final match. This one play, this one play, that 1-1, no goal. The other 2-2, no. They have to have a winner. It's okay, let's give them extra time. And the 90 minutes was complete. Let's give them extra time. And that extra time, they begin to struggle. They begin to try. Who is going to score? Who is everybody? Labor hard. And paraventure, somebody scores. What happens? Those people that are scoring will be praying for the final whistle to blow. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah, so they keep laboring. They want the final whistle to blow. So, just like the final whistle of the referee will end the extra time on the football pitch, the trumpet of the archangel will end the extra time of this world. Do you get what I'm saying? And the angels are set, but we are not set. But we are the people of this kingdom. The people that want to occupy the kingdom are not ready. The person that has gone to get the kingdom is there. Jesus Christ is set, but his people are not yet ready. Amen. But any moment from now, the extra time is ready. You just hear the song, ba-ba-da-da-da, that song. And whatever you found doing becomes what you answer for. And there is no grace after them. Would you like to see what the Bible says? This same Daniel, I told you, God revealed so many things to him. And at a point in time, God had to start revealing future to him. Look at 7:9. Daniel 7:9. So, and I beheld till thrones was cast down, and the ancient of days did sit, whose garment was as white as snow, and his hair, the hair of his head, like pure wool, and his throne was like fiery flame, and wheels as burning fire. Verse 22. So, until the ancient of days came, and the judgment. And judgment was given to the saint of the Most High God. And the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. But do you know the kingdom? Do you understand what I'm saying? The ancient of days came. Thrones were set. I said now, among those thrones, the ancient of days at this present time is sitting on that throne called the throne of grace. Calling you, you can be saved. Now you can be saved. But very soon he stands up, he sits on the next throne, called the throne of judgment. Then his eyes that was looking so tender, will begin to blaze with fire. And the kingdom has come with him. You can be surprised, we talked about the cornerstone. Amen. See what the Bible said in the book of Isaiah, chapter 28. Isaiah 28, as we round up, 16. Isaiah 28, 16, see what it says? Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believeth shall not... Another version will say that believers shall not be destroyed. And now we say, he that believeth shall not perish. Amen. Amen. The Lord has laid this stone for us. And do you want to know who that stone is? Would you like to see it from Matthew? And see, chapter 21, verse 42 to 43. It said, Jesus said unto them, did you never read in the scriptures? that the stone which the builders rejected, the same is become head of the corner. Said, this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Said, therefore, I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to the nation, bringing forth fruit thereof. Jesus was talking about himself, and he's bringing the kingdom. The cornerstone laid down in Zion. Now, the deliberation I said we are going to make today, we have come to that point. The deliberation is this. Are you going to be a part of that kingdom? Are you willing? We are just trying to gather the people that forms of that kingdom now. The kingdom that will abide forever. Every other kingdom came, and was every one of them was destroyed. And they blew off like chaff before the wind. But now a kingdom everlasting is coming. We are trying to gather the people for it. Are you willing to be part of them? Where the Lord God himself shall rule, and we shall be the citizen of the kingdom. Bow down your heads and talk to God at this very moment. The decision is here now. Do you want to be part of that kingdom? The kingdom of this world will be destroyed. Everything, this earth will melt with fervent heat and the element thereof, and nothing shall remain. But the kingdom is coming, a kingdom eternal. This is the chance we have to enroll, to enlist as part of this kingdom. Are you going to be there? The question comes to you, are you in that number saved by grace? This is just a period of grace. The trumpet of God is ending this season. Are you ready to go with him if he comes now? Are you there while your eyes are closed? You have not given your life to Jesus. Raise up your right hand. You cannot be a part of the kingdom if you don't do this. Raise up your right hand and let's pray together. The Lord is willing to save you. The Bible says, wherefore he is able to save to the uttermost everyone that comes to God by him. Are you ready to meet with your God? Are you prepared? Raise up your right hand if you are there and you are not yet saved. The Lord wants to save you now. While our eyes are closed, raise up your hand. Let me pray with you and let's continue with what we are doing. Do you want to be part of that kingdom? Let our eyes be closed. Do you want to be there? The angel of the Lord is here right now, enlisting the names of every citizen of that kingdom in the book of life. Where is your name? Is it that book of life? Or is it the book of sinners? Oh, they are listed in the book of liars. Is your name there? The book of fornicators. Is your name there? The book of backbite. Is your name there? In gossip. Is your name there? The book of murderers. Is your name there? The book of the drunkards. Is your name there? Or is your name in the book of life? There's a new name written down in glory. Is yours there? If you are there and not giving life to Christ, I'm giving you the last chance. Raise up your hand as we pray together. Said many shall come to him that day. They will say, in your name we cast out devils. Somebody will tell them, go, I never knew you. So we ate together. Yes, you are coming once again. We are going to eat together. Then the Lord Jesus will say unto them, no, I never knew you. That will not be your portion. If you have not given your life to Christ, this is a chance for you. Or you have once given your life to Christ before, but you know you are really not living like a Christian, the Lord is ready to save you now. And put your name. You know, your name is not there if you have not been living as a Christian. If you have not been living a holy life, your name is not there. But he wants to put your name now and list you among the people of that kingdom. Raise up your hand as we pray together. All eyes be closed. All eyes be closed. Let all eyes be closed. Are you in that number saved by grace? Begin to confess your sins to God at this very moment. Open up to God. Say, Lord, have mercy upon me. I regret the hours I've tasted and the pleasures I've tasted. I've wasted my life. Say, Lord, forgive me my sins. Enroll me in that kingdom. Enroll me in that kingdom. Make me worthy to reign with you. Make me worthy to reign with you. The Bible says in the book of Revelation, chapter 11, verse 15, that the kingdom of this world has become that of God and his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Are you worthy? Are you that number saved by grace? Thank you, Jesus. Confess your sins to God and reconcile with him. He's able to save you, and he will save you. In Jesus' name we pray. Eternal Father, we worship for a time like this. We thank you, Lord, for your word. We say be exalted in Jesus' name. Father, we pray, oh Lord, every heart that will receive this word of yours, may it have a root in them in the name of Jesus. Amen. Father, on that great day, it might be this night, it might be tomorrow, it might be any time, when you shall appear, make us worthy to be there in your kingdom in Jesus' name. Amen. Every sin that is beset us, every weight that pulls us down, Father, take away from us, sanctify us completely in the name of Jesus. Amen. Make our heart constantly ready for your coming in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for you've done it. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Amen. God bless you once again, and thanks for your time, and the Lord will uphold you there.